All right. Good morning, saints. Welcome to Wellspring Bible Fellowship. We are here to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. I encourage you to find your seats, or at least find your sitting area where you can stand. All right, saints, we're going to read the Word of God. Psalm 77, at verse 11, I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your wonders of old. I will ponder all your work and meditate on your mighty deeds. Your way, O God, is holy. What God is great like our God? You are the God who works wonders. You have made known your might among the peoples. You, with your arm, redeemed your people, the children of Jacob and Joseph. Let us worship the Lord this morning.
For the throne.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hand, my name is written on his heart. No tongue can bid me this depart.
Satan tempts.
When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, made an end of all my sin. Because a sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. To look on
Hold him there.
Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect, spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace.
And himself.
One with himself I cannot die. My soul is purchased by his blood. My soul is hid with Christ on high. With Christ my Savior and my God.
Because a sinless
Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied. God in and pardon me. Look on him and pardon me.
Hallelujah. Let's pray, church. Lord Jesus, we love you. We thank you for these songs that have stood the test of time and glorify your holy name. Let's pray for your blessing over the service, Lord, as we continue to sing to you. So we hear from your word, Lord, just the gathering of the saints, such an amazing privilege that we get to share. So, Lord, I just pray that you'd be here, you'd shape us to be more like you, you'd bless the rest of this time that we get to spend together. We ask these things in your name. And everybody said, amen. Let's take some time and greet each other this morning. It is our hope.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence? That our souls to Him belong, who holds our days within His hand. What comes apart from His command, and what will keep us to the end? The love of Christ in which we stand.
Oh, sing.
Oh, sing hallelujah. Our hope springs eternal. Oh, sing Christ, our hope in life and death.
Truth can calm.
What truth can calm the troubled soul? God is good, God is good. Where is His grace and goodness known? In our grace arise, who stands above the stormy trial, who sends the waves that bring us nigh unto the shore, the rock of Christ.
Oh, sing.
song. shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful and mighty God.
Three persons. Alone of my sorrow.
Alone of my sorrow and dead in my sin. Lost without hope, with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began.
Asher's Dean.
Ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given to me. death was arrested and my life began.
Oh, your grace.
Oh, your grace so free washes over me. You have made me new, now life begins with you. It's your endless love pouring down on us. You have made us new, now life begins with you. These are my chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began.
Oh, your grace.
Oh, your grace. So free washes over. Darkness rejoices as though heaven had gone. But then Jesus arose with our freedom again. That's when death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your
Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Lord, we love worshiping your holy name. It's so amazing to hear the saints cry out to you praises, truths about you, your great gospel, what you've done for us, Lord, how you defeated death by your own hand. You destroyed death for us for all of eternity. Truly too big for us to truly understand in this life, Lord, but I just pray that you'd give us more understanding. You'd help us, Lord, to be more faithful to that understanding. In our daily lives, Lord, help us to be more worshipful in our daily lives. And Lord, I just pray that you do some of that work right now as we hop into your word, hear from it, Lord. You're from the great letter to the Ephesians, Lord, such an encouraging letter about what you have done through your Son on the cross for now, not just the Jews, but the rest of the world. So, Lord, now engage us, Lord. Pray that our eyes would be on you. And, Lord, I just pray that you'd speak to us and change us through the preaching of your word. We love you and we ask this in your name. And everybody said, amen. You may have a seat.
Morning, saints. We are today, once again, in Ephesians 1, reading again, verses 3 through 14. If you'll turn there. If you're using the House Bible, that is on page 1159. 1159 in the House Bible. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love, he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace, with which he has blessed us in the Beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it, to the praise of his glory. May God bless the reading and now the preaching of his word.
Let's say a prayer together. Lord, help me now to preach your word and do your mighty, gracious, spiritual work amongst your people in our hearts and minds, because we know, we believe that your word, perfect, infallible, authoritative, and sufficient, that it washes over us, renewing us, changing us from the inside out, from one degree of glory to the next, bit by bit being sanctified to be like Jesus. And so we know that this morning plays a role in that process of making us, conforming us into the image of Jesus Christ. Do that this morning. I can't do that. I can't find the right words or preach at the right volume or find the right equation that will equal that in people's hearts. But you can, Lord, and that's why we believe the power rests in the Word. The Word rightly interpreted, understood, preached, and applied. So do that work by the Spirit, we ask now, for our sanctification and for your glory, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, there's the story of a little boy who one day decided to make a little sailboat. And he got some pieces of wood. He carved them out and glued them together, made a little boat. And then he built a little mast and he put that on the boat, made a little sail and attached it. And he worked really hard with his little tools and he produced to him what was a very special little sailboat. His, right? And he painted it the way he wanted, and finally he was ready to go take it on its first sail, and he took it to the lake nearby and put it out to sail, and it was carried along by a strong breeze and eventually got beyond his reach and then went out of sight. And he was sad. He was sad about losing his little prize of his own craftsmanship. And later he was walking through his small town where he lived, and he noticed through the shop window of one of the stores, he noticed his sailboat for sale there in the shop. And he went inside and he told the shopkeeper that it was his, and he tried to lay claim to it. He was not believed, however, And the man behind the counter demanded if he wanted it, he'd have to pay for it. He'd have to buy the very boat that he had made with his own hands. And he went home and he broke open his little piggy bank and he found that he had just enough money. And so he returned to the shop and he put his money on the counter and he bought back his little boat. And it was surely his now, twice his, he said, because not only had he made it, but he had redeemed it. Church, this morning, you and I are twice his, because not only have we been made by God, but we've been redeemed by God. Redemption is the story of Christianity. Redemption is the heart of the gospel. Redemption answers the question of how exactly God is going to accomplish what he has set out to accomplish in his eternal decree of saving and adopting those whom he's chosen and predestined to be his, what we've been looking at in verses 3 through 6. If he is choosing sinners to be his children forever, how exactly does God plan to work that out? What was going to be his method to bring these elect people into this reality that he planned? How was he going to make this relationship with the chosen really happen? The answer? Redemption. Redemption. The plan was always to redeem us, buy us back through the Redeemer, Jesus Christ, his own Son. This is now where Paul turns in verse 7 of our passage that we've been slowly taking piece by piece here, where Paul, starting in verse 3, he's extolling God, he's worshiping God, he's blessing the Lord for all the abundant spiritual blessings that we have in Christ Jesus, the blessings of election and predestination and adoption. And now we come to verse 7, the blessing of redemption. Redemption, the big idea for your notes. You've been blessed with redemption and forgiveness in Christ. If you're a Christian here this morning, you've been blessed with redemption and forgiveness in Christ. Look at verse 7 again. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of his grace. Number one for your notes, firstly, you've been redeemed in Christ. You've been redeemed in Christ. You notice those first words of verse 7. In him we have redemption. In him we have redemption. Now that word redemption means, simply put, deliverance by the payment of a price. Deliverance by the payment of a price. It indicates a release or a liberation from imprisonment or captivity. And the words used 10 times in the New Testament, 7 of them by the Apostle Paul, one of them here. And in the Greek, there was different words that could be translated redemption that he could have used. The first word, agorazo, which would mean to buy out of the marketplace, to purchase something, to make it yours. So you're going to the store, you're buying food, you're buying jewelry, whatever it is. You're purchasing it, you're making it yours. But that's not the word used here in verse 7. Here we have the Greek word latruo, and it's a much stronger word, and it means to pay a price to free somebody from bondage, to redeem someone in bondage. Now, in that, a Greek or a Roman of that day would have heard that word, latruo, and they would have immediately understood this concept because this part of the world, there were about 6 million slaves in the Roman Empire. And so buying and selling slaves was a common thing. They bought and sold slaves just like they did animals. And from time to time, someone might desire to buy a slave, purchase a slave, for the purpose of then setting them free. And that is that word, latruo, the word for we get redemption. Paul here says, in him we have redemption. We have the price, that the purchase that sets us free. The price paid that sets us free. Therefore, redemption implies that we are captives, that we are needing to be set free, that we're slaves needing deliverance, right? Unpopular truth for today, no man is free. No man is free, spiritually speaking. Every person is born a slave. Now, to whom are we enslaved? Who is the captor of every man? Listen to the words of Jesus in John 8:34. Jesus said, everyone who commits sins is a slave to what? Sin. A slave to sin. Romans 6:17, men are pronounced there slaves of sin. Romans 7:14, we are sold under sin. Romans 8:21, in bondage to corruption. Man is in bondage. We are enslaved. And who are we enslaved to? Sin. Sin is the captor that holds men. And what we need is a redeemer who will pay the price that sets us free. And here's the gloriously good news that Paul says in verse 7, in him we have that redemption. We have that redemption. Now, who is the him? Who is the him? Look at the end of verse 6. The beloved. It's the beloved. It's Jesus. It's God's beloved Son. In him, the beloved, we have redemption. Notice it does not say in ourselves, right? We are not self-redeemed. We need a redeemer. Christ is our redeemer. He is the beloved of the Father, who on multiple occasions was declared by the Father to be my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Why was it that Jesus was so pleasing to the Father? Why is it that Jesus is so uniquely qualified to be the only redeemer of all mankind? It's because he alone is without sin. He's not captive to sin like us. It's because he alone is the infinitely perfect, holy, righteous, obedient Son of God. He alone is the one who perfectly fulfilled the requirements of the law, the righteous requirement of the law, through his sinless life. And therefore, he alone was worthy to be the precious sacrifice for payment of sin. This is why Christ alone is the Redeemer. Again, number one, you have been redeemed in Christ. Number two, for your notes, you've been redeemed through his blood, we learn here. You've been redeemed through his blood. Verse 7 again, in him we have redemption through his blood. So sin, as we talked about, it holds men captive. Justice demands a price to be paid for sinners to be liberated, to be set free. And that price, according to the scriptures, is what? Death. Blood. Right? Romans 6:23. Some of our children here this morning got to know Romans 6:23, right? The wages of sin is what? Death. I heard adults, but where's our Awana kids at? The wages of sin is death. The price of sin is death. In order to purchase sinners from the grasp of sin, there must be death. Hebrews 9:22, without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Ezekiel 18, verse 20, the soul who sins shall die, because that's what sin deserves, death. So the price that had to be paid for redemption is death. Paul says what? In him we have redemption through his blood, through his death, through the cross, right? This is what Christ did to redeem us at the cross, specifically his death, okay? We praise the Lord for his sinless life, but that is not alone what redeems us from our sins. It's what he did on the cross. We praise the Lord for the moral example of Jesus in his earthly life, but that does not redeem us from our sins. It's what he did on the cross. The cross is what redeems us. He paid the price of sin on behalf of the slaves so that we, the slaves, might be set free. Free, free, we were just singing this morning. Now, before you get the wrong idea, though, of redemption, let me ask and answer this question. Who or what determined that the price sin demands is death? Who determined that? Was it sin? Is sin some kind of force or presence in the universe that told God what the price is going to be? No. Was it Satan? Does Satan, the ultimate evil, does he own us through sin? And he's telling God what it's going to require if God wants to get us back as his children. And so God made a payment to Satan to redeem us? No. Absolutely not. Listen closely. The only one who determined the penalty of sin would be death, and that Christ's death would be the way to redeem us, is God Almighty in accordance with his perfect holiness and righteousness. That is his standard for sin against his holy name. Sin is evil and worthy of death and eternal judgment precisely because God is holy and worthy of eternal worship and glory. That is what makes sin so evil. When we sin, we defame the eternal, infinite glory of God, and that is the highest treason because God is the highest glory and sovereignty in the universe. And that's what makes every sin so evil. So when I say that Jesus is paying the price that sin demands to set us free, understand we're talking about Jesus satisfying the righteous demands of his Father against our sin. It's Jesus propitiating, satisfying the wrath of God and redeeming us out from under that wrath and punishment that we might be reconciled to God and know his love. That we might be able to confidently say this morning, if God is for us, who can be against us? That's what the cross accomplished. It was a transaction, not between Jesus and sin or Jesus and Satan. It was a transaction between the Son of God and the Father. And something objective happened there that sets us free. This is redemption. Redemption through his blood, as Paul says it here. Now, that phrase, through his blood, it's all over the New Testament, right? But we don't hear that, and we don't have a mystical or superstitious understanding of the blood of Christ when we read that. We don't believe that there are these, you know, actual molecules in the physical blood of Jesus that somehow have the ability to forgive us of our sins, okay? It's not the physical blood, right? So the Roman guards that crucified Jesus, they probably got some of his blood splattered on them. It did not wash away their sins, right? By blood, we mean his life poured out in death, right? Our life is in the blood. By blood, we mean it represents the sacrifice he made for us at the cross to death. His life given in our place. Redemption by blood just means redemption in his sacrificial death. This is the way the New Testament speaks about it. Acts 20 at verse 28 speaks of the church of God which he bought with his own blood. You hear that? He bought. That's redemption. That's the purchase. How did he do it? With his own blood through his death at the cross. Colossians 1 at verse 20, he made peace through his blood shed on the cross. The blood is about the cross, his death. Hebrews 10:19, therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place, how? By the blood of Jesus. Luke 22, verse 20, there at the Lord's Supper, Jesus said, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Where was it poured out? It's poured out there on Calvary. Romans 5:9, since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? It's because his death was a propitiating sacrifice that the wrath of God is satisfied by the blood of his own Son. And so in him, we have redemption through his blood, meaning his death, his sacrifice, his life poured out on the cross. He paid the price that sets us free, and that price was his own life. How valuable was that sacrifice? Which makes you realize how great was our trespass, our debt before God, that it required the sacrifice of the infinitely holy Son of God in our place. Redemption through blood. Now, this idea of redemption through blood was foreshadowed all throughout the Old Testament, most prominently Exodus 12. You'll recall there in Exodus that the descendants of Abraham at this time were all slaves in Egypt. God had rescued Joseph and his family to go down to Egypt during the famine. Now, 400 years later, and many, many, many babies later, you have 2 to 3 million Israelites, Jews, that Joseph is forgotten, and they're now an enslaved people by Pharaoh, right? And God is going to deliver them, so he sends Moses to deliver them. And after 9 devastating plagues on the Egyptians and on Pharaoh, God told the Israelites before the 10th judgment to take a lamb, each family, kill the lamb at twilight, and then spread the blood of that lamb on the lintel and the doorposts of your home. Why? Because that night the Lord is going to pass through the land of Egypt and strike all the firstborn of man and animal. He's going to bring a judgment, but he promised the Israelites that he will what? Pass over the homes that have the blood of the lamb on the door. Why? Because they've been redeemed by the Passover lamb. They've been redeemed through blood. God used this to deliver his people out of bondage in Egypt, literally. Redemption. Great picture of redemption. The scriptures refer to that moment of bringing them out of Egypt again and again as their redemption moment. God taking them to himself as his people. Fast forward a few thousand years. Now we have, at the beginning of Jesus' earthly ministry, John the Baptist, his cousin, sees Jesus and says what? Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus is the Lamb who redeems the world eternally. All else was a foreshadowing of Jesus, the Redeemer. Listen to 1 Peter 1 at verse 18. 1 Peter 1:18. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from the ancestors, but it was with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. Jesus Christ, the Lamb, the Redeemer, through his blood. Thomas Watson, great Puritan preacher, said this: great was the work of creation, but greater is the work of redemption. It cost more to redeem us than to make us. In the one, there was but the speaking of a word. In the other, there was the shedding of blood. The creation was but the work of God's fingers. Redemption is the work of his arm. Psalm 136, he struck down the firstborn of Egypt and brought Israel out from among them with a strong hand and an outstretched arm. This is the mighty work of redemption through the blood of Jesus. Number two, again, you've been redeemed through his blood. Number three for your notes, what we learned this morning, you've been redeemed and forgiven. You've been redeemed and forgiven. There again at verse 7, in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses. What is the result this morning of our redemption according to the text? Forgiveness of our trespasses, another word for sins. Forgiveness. It's not the only result of redemption. But here it is the most prominent one in many passages, forgiveness specifically. Now remember where we are in the context. We're in chapter 1 of Ephesians, where Paul is hearkening back to eternity past. And speaking of these things that God has done before the foundations of the world in his plan, and that thought is going to carry through the passage, that these are things that have been predestined. So we're back in the mind of God before anything was made, and we're learning that your sins, my sins, were already in God's mind, totally forgiven before the world ever created. What a thought. Some Christians go around so depressed because they think God is just going to hold everything against them, right? No. Romans 8:1, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Why? Because in him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses. And when were we chosen in him? Verse 4, before the foundation of the world, we were chosen in him. When God chose you in Christ and he predestined you for adoption as sons, he also predestined your redemption through Christ, the Redeemer. And at that point in his mind, he dismissed your sin from his thoughts forever before you were born. So just how forgiven are you this morning, Christian? How forgiven are you? Listen to Psalm 103, verse 12. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. How far is the east from the west? The idea there is unending, infinite. Micah 7 at verse 19, he will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. The idea there being buried, forgotten, gone. Not going down to pull those up, right? The depths of the sea. This is the glorious result of our redemption. Forgiveness of every sin, past, present, and future. What can be better than that, Christian? Seriously. What could be more important than that? Because we all will have to stand before a holy God one day who is the judge of the universe, and we all will be naked and laid bare before him. Every sinful thought, every evil deed, every intention of the heart, every word spoken, every action taken, and you and I are 100% guilty and condemned by it all, and yet we have a Redeemer, Jesus, who steps in, shows the scars on his hands and feet, the one who died, who rose again for us, and the Father looks on him, and he sees us, and he says what? Not guilty. Forgiven. Justified. Righteous, forgotten, wiped away, washed clean, pardoned. Hallelujah. As far as the east is from the west, all of it, all of it, all of it gone. All the weight of that sin gone. All the shame of it gone. All the burden of it gone. All the guilt of it gone. All the fear of judgment gone. No condemnation. All the embarrassment of it, all the self-hatred from it, gone forever. Forgiven. Forgiven in Christ Jesus. There is no better news in the universe than that I can be forgiven by God. When we sin against one another, oh, we long for that forgiveness. We want to be reconciled. But who cares if my brother or my friend forgives me, but God doesn't forgive me for that sin. Right? Because he's the one who has power to cast body and soul into hell. We need forgiveness from God. That is what Christ brings us. This is why King David said in Psalm 32, verse 1, Blessed is the man whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord counts no iniquity. That word blessed, happy. Do you feel it? When you realize it's gone, happy is the man who has no sin as he stands before the Lord, forgiven. Church, do you know how much you've been forgiven this morning? Just how blessed we are with the redemption of Jesus Christ. Because if we really knew, I mean, just think about the effect it ought to have on our lives, on my life, right? Would we be so somber at times, or so ungrateful at times, or so depressed at times, or so easily discouraged by our sin? Would we feel so little love for Jesus as we often do if we really knew how much we were forgiven? I want you to consider the response of the sinful woman in Luke chapter 7 and what our response should be this morning to the grace and forgiveness of our Lord Jesus Christ. There in Luke 7, I'll summarize it. The woman there was so humbled by the presence of Jesus as he was dining there. She's weeping and kissing his feet and anointing his feet with expensive oil, pouring out her humble, brokenhearted, grateful adoration and love for Jesus. And the Pharisee, Simon, in whose house Jesus is dining, was indignant, ultimately because he was self-righteous and blind to his own sin, too proud to seek Christ for forgiveness. And that really is the only difference between the sinful woman and the Pharisee. One was humbled and one was proud. Both are sinful. And Simon says, "Don't you know the woman who is touching you is a sinner?" And Jesus says, "You know, you gave me no water when I came, and she has not ceased to wash my feet with her tears. Her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. Whoever is forgiven little loves little." The woman found forgiveness for much sin, and she poured out her affection and love on Jesus. The man who saw no need for forgiveness or only little need for forgiveness, he loved little, or he did nothing to show his love for Jesus. Do you really reckon how much you've been forgiven this morning? And if so, then let us pour out our humble, grateful adoration and love on Jesus. Amen? Again, number three, you have been redeemed and forgiven, which brings me to lastly, number four, you've been redeemed by grace. You've been redeemed by grace. There at the end of the verse, "In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us." What did you do this morning, Christian, to deserve this forgiveness? Nothing. 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 Then on what account are we forgiven and redeemed? On account of the riches of God's grace. Oh, his grace so free, washing over me. We are absolutely undeserving, but our God is rich in grace. He's wealthy in undeserved favor. He has reserves of grace without limit, because they correspond to our great God, who his very essence is himself without limit. Paul doesn't just say here that God showed us some grace, a little grace. It says at the beginning of verse 8, actually, he says he lavished it upon us. According to the riches of his grace which he lavished upon us. That word lavish means exceeding all measure. So picture the grace of God this morning to you, Christian, his predestined child. Picture it like the ocean waves. And they just keep coming, and they keep coming, and they keep coming, and they never stop. And it's wave after wave of grace washing over us with his forgiveness for all our sins. God is intentionally using words here to express how superabundantly, extravagantly, lavishly he has given us grace. Why? Because he wants our hearts to be superabundantly assured of his love and forgiveness. Right? Think about it. He could just state it. You've been forgiven. I will be gracious to you. And we should believe it, right? But here he is. He's using terminology to show just how extravagant it is, because he knows we are weak. He knows that we need help believing and really living in these realities. So he says it's lavish. He lavished it upon us. God's grace is not, you know, squeezed out from a little eyedropper. It's not carefully rationed as in a time of drought, right? His grace toward us is like the Niagara Falls. 200,000 tons of water a minute plunging over the edge of heaven into our hearts. This is the lavish grace of God. And you notice Paul doesn't just say it was out of the riches of his grace there at the end of verse 7. Out of the riches. No, he says what? According to the riches of his grace. And there's an important difference there. For example, if you go to, say, Elon Musk and ask for a contribution to some worthy cause you're fundraising for, and he gives you $100 or he gives you $1,000, right? He's given out of his riches. But if Elon Musk hands you a blank check and says, fill in what you need, now he's given according to his riches. You have been redeemed and forgiven according to the riches of his grace. This is what God means to convey to his children here through this passage, just how rich he is and how lavish he is in grace toward us, because he knows our frame. He remembers that we are just dust. He knows we're prone to worry. He knows we're prone to fear. He knows we're prone to wander. He knows we're prone to leave the God we love. And he wants you to know today that the measure of God's forgiveness of your sins is not you. It's not according to how much you flagellate yourself for your sins. It's not according to how much you mourn over your sins, though we should surely mourn. It's not according to how much you can repay. Rather, the measure of God's forgiveness is according to the riches of his grace lavished upon us. If today you are trusting in Christ as your sin-bearing redeemer, God wants you to experience the extravagant, lavish grace in the forgiveness of all your sins. Do you experience it, Christian? Do you experience the joy? Do you experience the freedom that we were just singing about? Do you experience the weight being lifted? Do you experience the liberty of it all? Do you experience the hope of it all? Do you experience the love of God through it all? Now, if you're thinking this morning, careful, Pastor, you keep preaching like this, people are going to go out and they're going to abuse grace and they're going to sin, knowing that they can just be forgiven. Pastor said it's endless. They got a blank check now. Now, if you thought that, you know, careful, that means my preaching's on the right track. Because when Paul was preaching this doctrine in Romans 5 and 6, he anticipated the same kind of potential misunderstanding. There at the end of chapter 5, Paul speaks of where sin abounds, grace abounds all the more. Oh man, that sounds like you're giving us a license to sin. Chapter 6, verse 1, what shall we say then? Shall we continue to sin that grace may abound? Certainly not. How can we who died to sin live any longer in it? If you're someone who truly knows the grace the extravagant grace of God this morning, you know that you could never dare treat grace like that because your heart has been changed by grace. You've died to sin. Your heart is now bound in love to Christ. You are growing in your hatred of sin every day. You're striving all the more to turn away and walk away from it and walk in a way that pleases the one who shed his blood for you. And so, no, we're not going to abuse grace. But God, knowing that his true children, false converts will certainly abuse grace, but his true children, what do we need? He knows we are so easily discouraged by our sin. He knows that we're so easily frustrated and getting wanting to give up when it comes to our fight against sin. You feel that? You feel that before? So that God here gives us a word of overwhelming assurance that we know that we are truly and fully forgiven today. Now, if you are here this morning and you are a wretched sinner like the rest of us, but you don't know the grace and forgiveness of Jesus Christ, I want you to listen to God's appeal to you right now through me. Isaiah 55, verse 6. Hear the word of the Lord to you today. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return to the Lord, and he will have compassion on him. And return to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. You need to turn, repent, and believe in Jesus, and God will abundantly, lavishly pardon all your sins today. Let me close with the story of a young woman who found this amazing grace one night. She showed up to a church service in the amazing providence of God. And there, as she was hearing the preaching, God opened her heart to his call and to his gospel. She believed on Jesus as Savior and Lord. And that woman found amazing grace and forgiveness that night. And she repented of a very rough past, including alcohol, drugs, prostitution. And her life was transformed by grace, and over time, she became a faithful member of the church, and she even began serving by teaching the children in kids' ministry. And down the road, this young woman caught the eye and the heart of the pastor's son. And the relationship grew, and they began making wedding plans. That's when the problems began. Many in the church did not think that a woman with such a past as hers was suitable for the pastor's son. And so the church began to gossip and argue about this matter, and they decided finally to have a church meeting. And their emotions heated up, and the tension increased, and the meeting got out of hand. And the young woman became very upset because all these things that were being said about her past, and she began to cry. And the pastor's son stood to speak. He said, "My fiance's past is not what is on trial here. What you are questioning is the ability of the blood of Jesus to wash away sin. Today you have put the blood of Jesus on trial. So, does it wash away sin or not?" And the whole church began to weep as they realized they had been slandering the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Church, either that is true or it is not, right? And if that is not true, then we are in a lot of trouble. Or if that only washes away the minor sins but not the major ones, we are in a lot of trouble. Or if that only works if we also buy indulgences, or if we also do good works, if we also do ritual, if we also do baptism, if we also do all these other things, then what good is that? We thank God this morning for the clear truth of verse 7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us. Cling to this truth every day, saints. Father, We thank you for this great plan of redemption that was eternal with you and has been worked out in history through the coming of your Son, Jesus, to be our Lamb slain for us, that we might have redemption and forgiveness. And we know that Jesus was a Lamb slain from before the foundation of the world. When it comes to your plan, we were already forgiven. We were already yours. You knew us. You made us your own. There's nothing that's going to stop you, to stop you from fulfilling what you have purposed. And that is for our good. That is us knowing your love. That is us finding salvation in Christ and eternal glory with him. God, thank you. We thank you as your people, humbled by forgiveness, humbled by the grace you've shown. And we pray for any soul in this room that is still unregenerate and going through the motions or believing false things, that you would open hearts and minds even now to true grace, as only you can do. Sovereign grace would impart this life to their soul right now, that they might see and believe and be saved through the Redeemer Jesus. And Lord, we want to celebrate and rejoice and find our hope in Christ all our days, clinging to this truth. So help us do that by the power of the Holy Spirit. We give you all glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise. There rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Yes, your name is a strong, mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing you louder. There's nothing as a power. It's a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing louder. There's nothing as a power to say your name, but your name. Power to save, but your name.
say this together as a church. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." Have a blessed week, folks. It's last Sunday. We're going out and hitting the